My, what beautiful songs of praise that we just sang together. How would I glorify thy name in all the earth. We're going to talk about that this morning. If you've got your Bibles, hold them up. Beautiful sight. Turn to Revelation chapter 5 this morning, the last book in the Word of God. Revelation chapter 5, and let's talk this morning about glorifying that wonderful name and bowing down and worshiping our Lord. I don't know about you, but singing songs like that, I enjoy and worship here. What I really look forward to as you is the day that we can all be around that throne of God and glorify his name and bow down before him with those angels there, with that new body, that new voice that doesn't get tired, doesn't get sore, that we'll have that new incorruptible body, that we'll have bodies. Don't know what they'll be like, but John said they'll be like his. And I look forward to that time when we can be changed in the moment of the twinkling of an eye and be there with our Lord. We welcome you today to the family of God at Lone Cedar. Got a good assembly, got a lot of visitors today. We are very honored you've come our way, and we don't just say that you are special to us. If you are looking for a church home, please consider the family of God here at Lone Cedar, and fill out one of the cards and let us get to know you. We're thankful for Steve and Amy Mayfield that placed membership with us last Sunday. We love this sweet family so much, and I ask you to keep Amy and Steve in your prayers. Amy's going tomorrow for some tests, as well as our brother Roy Nagel. And let's pray for them as they're going for tests and others. It's good to see Sister Jean right here today, who has been in Texas at MD Anderson. She got some good news this past week, and we're thankful for that. I ask you to especially keep little Haley Murray in your prayers. I mean, if you know Haley, she's a member here, baptized her about a year ago, and she's 24 years old, but she's in Keller Hospital right now, and she's not doing very well at all. Had some surgery and found some new situations with her that are not good at this time, and they're looking at other options, but keep Haley Murray in your prayers continually, as this young lady certainly needs our prayers. So many others that do as well. I invite you back tonight at 6 o'clock to be with us and worship the Lord at that time. And by the way, VBS is only 2 weeks away, 2 weeks from today. Our Vacation Bible School starts, and a lot of work has already began for this. We're going to kick it off that Sunday, that Lord's Day, that evening. And afterwards, we'll have our fellowship and our annual fireworks that we have. The church does pay for those. They're provided and donated privately. But it's always a wonderful time, and so that will not be July the 3rd next Sunday, but it'll be July the 10th at our kickoff for our Vacation Bible School that evening on Sunday. Also, one other thing, our new church directories are here. We've waited a long time for those, and as you leave today, our ushers will be handing these out. They're a great tool for all of us in getting to know each other more and putting names with faces, and especially a great tool for our care groups and our evangelism, all the addresses and phone numbers and things that we need. And we just ask that you get one directory per family. We don't have enough for everybody, so we want every family to get one, so please make sure you just get one per family so everyone can get one. And you may notice it's just a design. There's a marble texture to some of the pages. It looks like it's little smudges on them, but it's not. If you look closely, that is a marble background design, and these are very beautiful, and I appreciate Sister Tessa and all who helped in putting these together. You worked very hard, and we just thank you for that, Sandy Swagger and others. We just thank you all for what you've done in getting these together. If you're not a Christian today, I hope you'll listen closely to this message, and it'll make you want to realize how precious your soul is and how long eternity is going to be. And if you're not a Christian, come today and give your life to the Lord. Obey the gospel. Put him on in baptism today. Let that blood wash your sins away. Revelation chapter 5. Look at it, verses 8 through 14. John the apostle is writing this. He gets a glimpse of this worship scene in heaven. We all one day want to be a part of this worship scene. We're going to talk today about our worship and evaluate our worship and make sure that we are worshiping God the way that he wants us to, in spirit and in truth. Revelation 5, verse 8. Now when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, You are worthy to take the scroll and open its seals. For you were slain, and you have redeemed us to God by your blood, out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation. And have made us kings and priests to our God. We shall reign on the earth. Then I looked and I heard the voice of many angels round the throne, the living creatures and the elders. And get this picture in your mind, these angels. The number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands. And here's what they were doing. Verse 12, saying with a loud voice, Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth and such as are in the sea and all that are in them I heard saying, Blessing and honor and glory and power be to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever. Then the four living creatures said, Amen. And the 24 elders fell down and worshiped him who lives forever and ever. Now, when you look into the Word of God, we see there are three types of worship mentioned in the Bible. First of all, we see there is true worship, and that's what we want to be in. Where Jesus said in John 4:23, But the hour is coming and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father is seeking such to worship him. He wants our true worship. But then secondly, the Bible also speaks of vain worship. When Mark 7 verse 7, Jesus said to those scribes and Pharisees, For in vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. He said that's vain worship. And then thirdly, the Bible talks about ignorant worship. You remember in Acts 17, verse 23, as Paul passed through Athens there at Mars Hill, he saw many of their gods that they ignorantly worshipped, and he saw this one that says, to the unknown God of whom Paul said, you ignorantly worship. There are those today who worship dead gods. They don't know and worship the true and living God. So, in the Word of God, there is true, vain, and ignorant worship. And today, let's talk about our worship. I want to ask you this morning, what kind of worshiper are you? In our text, here in Revelation chapter 5, the Apostle John again gets a glimpse of this worship scene in heaven as he hears all these millions and millions of angels, 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands upon thousands, around the throne of God, bowing down and worshiping and saying, Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. So this morning, in this message, I want us to look deep into our hearts and evaluate our worship. And number one, I want us to see some observations about worship. And mainly, number two, of how we are to approach God in our worship. Of how we're to approach God. Long ago, King Solomon gave us some really good advice on how to approach God. How to come before him. In Ecclesiastes chapter 5 and verse 1, he says, walk prudently. That is, walk wisely when you go into the house of God. In other words, when you go through those doors, it better not be nonchalant, careless, disrespectful. But he said, you better walk wisely when you go into the house of God and meet with your Lord. You know, this is really a figurative expression of how careful we should be, of how our hearts are to be when we come before him to worship him. Now, let's suppose this morning we played a little candid camera. We're going to put it up here on the screens, maybe, of just how it has been for you since you got up this morning. And let's suppose we're going to analyze each one of us on just what's been going on with you and I since we got up this morning. Now, this is the day that we've come together to worship God. You've come to be with God's people. We have assembled here to worship him and praise him. But let's say we're going to show what it was like at your house this morning before you ever came into the house of God. I don't know how it was with you. Maybe things went well at your home this morning. You said, go ahead, preacher, put it up there. Just show away. Let's see it. But maybe it's been one of those mornings for you. And you say, no, please. Don't show what it's been like for me since I got up this morning. Don't know really what it was like for you today so far. But a lot of times, beloved, we really don't prepare ourselves. We don't really prepare our hearts the way that we ought to before we come through those doors and meet with our God. Maybe for you, last night, maybe you're going to bedtime was too close to your getting up time, and you're really tired this morning. Some of you, maybe you got really small children, and it was hard getting all those little boys and girls ready. And, you know, I'm sort of glad that our kids are past that. I remember how it was on Sunday morning when you had little babies and even up to 3 or 4 years old, and maybe you get one ready and the other one's throwing up or had a bad diaper. I remember that. And I remember Charmin saying about Tyler, she said, that boy can get dirty getting out of the bathtub. And he could. Well, kids can get into a lot. So it's not always easy when you've got small children, parents. I understand that. Maybe you've had a long, hard week at work this week. It's just been trying. Hard times for you, stress. But suppose this morning that we've got the video camera going in your life and in your home. We're observing what went on in your house. And maybe that little fuss you had with your husband or wife this morning before you ever got here. And how that you're fussing on those children. Get ready. Come on, we're late. Let's go. This is a rush world, isn't it? And all these things, and we're watching it all up here on the screens. Maybe some of you are like this. Please don't show any more. But you know what? The truth of it is, we may not know, and we don't know what went on at your home, but God does. God saw it all. He gives us 6 days, but this is the Lord's day. It's His day. It's a day we're to especially set aside for Him and to prepare our hearts and our minds in a way that we are ready to worship. We come into this house. We start singing those songs and think of those messages. We start praying along with that person leading in prayer. We have our Bibles out and we're in respect and reverence and honor to the Word of God as it is read and proclaimed. Let me ask you, did you come here today really ready to worship this morning? And I know I raise that question every now and then, but I need to hear it. And you need to hear it. And you and I need to ask ourselves, do I really prepare my mind? Do I really prepare my heart? Am I really here to worship God this morning? Or is it just something I come and do out of habit? Well, preacher, this is just something we do on Sunday mornings. Was it it? Or did I really anticipate and get my heart ready to come and be with God and be with His people and to honor Him today? Because He's here this morning. He's in this audience today and every time we meet. Ask yourself, did I come here today to really participate and worship around this audience and before the throne of God? Or did I come to spectate? Did I come and say and just fold my hands, preacher, entertain me? I'm here. I punched in. I'm here. That's all I need to do. I'm warming the pew. No. Did I really come today to worship at His feet and to praise and honor and magnify His precious name and thank Him for all the blessings He's given me in my life? You know, God didn't have to wake me up this morning. He doesn't owe me my next breath. He doesn't owe me a tomorrow. Life's a gift from God. It's not an obligation. No matter how old we are, caskets come in all sizes and all colors. So God, it's in Him that we live and we move and we have our very being. It's Him who holds our life in the palm of His hand, and He can call time on us at any time. None of us have a lease on life, and that's why when we come before Him, we need to thank Him. for all the blessings that we got. And we need to count our stars and not our scars always. And thank God, you know, there's always, we're going to have situations in our life. We're going to have problems. The Lord has never promised us to be exempt from any trials. But let's oftentimes, as we're going through these trials, let's remember to thank God for the blessings we do have as well. To remember how much He has blessed us, to look around, and it's always someone you can find who has more problems maybe than we do. You know, it's not a new problem, brethren, about this thing called worship. In fact, we learn in the Old Testament times, for instance, in Nehemiah chapter 13, that we learned that some folks there were having trouble as they were approaching God to worship Him and to do things His way. And the very reason God punished them was because of their lack of reverence and respect to Him and to His will. So many times we learn about worship also in the New Testament. And I don't mean to suggest in any way that our worship is to be cold and formal and ritualistic. In fact, it's to be just the opposite. When we come together, our emotions ought to be with us. Our emotions and our hearts ought to be there, and our hearts ready to worship. Yes, we do things right. We do things in the right way, by the right standard, and that is by the Word of God, but our hearts have to be right too, where it just doesn't work. John 4:23, Jesus said, God is a spirit. He's not flesh and bone. God is a spirit, and those that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. And it's a conjunction. It joins two things together. You can't worship Him in truth without spirit, or spirit without truth. Now, young people, what does it mean to worship God in spirit? He's talking there, that's a little S. Capital S is the Holy Spirit, a person. But it's in spirit, little S. Worship Him in spirit, that is the right frame of mind. Having your heart right. And your heart prepared to worship Him in spirit, in the right frame of mind, and in truth, the right standard. Following God's will and doing things His way, in Bible ways. So here the first observation that is made about our worship is that, beloved, we need to be coming here through these doors prepared, with our hearts right, to worship God. Preparation for worship. The second thing I want to see this morning is we're also to come here with a purpose. We're to come here with a purpose. And it's not always what I get out of worship, but what I give in worship. God's the audience. He's the one that's to be praised and honored and magnified, and not us. Not being selfish, well, I want to be entertained. I want more excitement. No. It's all about God, isn't it? We're here to worship Him because it's His day. Again, Ecclesiastes 5 and verse 1, Solomon says, draw near to hear. Listen to God. Draw near to hear rather than to give the sacrifice of fools, for they do not know that they do evil. Do not be rash with your mouth. Brethren, hear this morning. We come together. We're not coming here to show God how good we are. We're coming to learn how good He is. How great He is. We sing that song, how great thou art, not us. We're coming to offer our praise because He is worthy. It's because of His gift of His Son on Calvary and that shed blood that makes us good. Brother, there must be purpose in our worship. We sing that song oftentimes, worthy of praise is Christ my Redeemer. Worthy of glory, honor, and power. Worthy of all our soul's adoration. Worthy art thou. Do you know where that song comes from? Because we're right here in our text. Revelation 5, verse 11. Again, John records, and I beheld, and I heard the voice of many angels around that throne again. 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands upon thousands. And here's what they were saying with a loud voice. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessings. So we see, we come into this house to magnify His name and worship Him. To offer our praise and worship unto Him because He is worthy. Why? He died in our place. When you saw that scene of that cross up here this morning and you looked at that cross, it should have been you and I hanging on that cross, not Jesus. But he loved us so much, he died in our place. Not that we were so good that we deserved it, but he died for us while we were yet sinners. He bore our sins on his back who knew no sin. He bore our iniquities. And by his stripes, we are healed. And we never, beloved, come to worship because we feel like we have to. Boys and girls, young people, please don't come into this house because mom and dad make you. I pray and I trust that you realize how much God has blessed you with time and talents and abilities, and you come here because you want to. Not because you feel like I have to. If I don't, I'll go to hell. No. Don't ever come out of a heart of obligation. But come to worship him out of a heart of love. Say, thank you, God, for giving me another day. Thank you for your son. Thank you for salvation. Thank you that when I die and I leave this old world, I've got a home worth going to. A place of light, not a place of outer darkness. Those that are lost and outside of Christ Jesus today are living in fear and dread of the tomb because, you know, when they live in this old world, they're going to a home of outer darkness, a lake of fire forever and ever and forever, where the smoke of their torment is set up forever and ever, and there is no rest day or night. I couldn't live with that thought. So we're to come before him with a purpose in our hearts. It's not showing up here and saying, God, did you see how good I've been this week? I've had a pretty good week. I haven't made a lot of mistakes this last week. I've had a good week. No. It's always coming with a purpose to know that God is worthy of everything that we can give him in our worship for his goodness. And that includes our time, our talents. Are you using your talents for the Lord? Are you doing anything for the Lord? Have you just backed up and had a bad attitude and just quit all your working for the Lord? There's no evangelism. You've not told nobody about the Lord lately. We owe him our time, our talents, our devotion, our offering, but most of all, our hearts. Because if he don't have your heart, what does he really have of you? Where your treasure is, where your interests are, there will your heart be also. Is God on the throne of your heart this morning? So we see we're to come before God with a purpose. And then thirdly, we see there's also perspective in our worship. Perspective. Realizing just where we are in God's eyes. In Ecclesiastes chapter 5, the latter part of verse 2, the Bible says, "For God is in heaven and you on earth." He's looking down. He knows our every move. He knows our every thought. He knows our every little secret. Those little secrets we may have sometimes we think nobody knows. God does. He knows us better than we know ourselves. God is in heaven and you on earth. Now there is a sense, and again, which God is with us today, that the Lord is with us today, Jesus. His Spirit is in our midst. Matthew 18:20, Jesus promised, "Where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in your presence also." Now, we're the church of Christ at Lone Cedar, aren't we? And this church, this body of people, we could meet out here under an oak tree and we're still the church of Christ at Lone Cedar. Or someone's home. We are the church as individual members. But whenever we come together, wherever we are, especially in this place here that we have, that we're blessed with, he says, "I'm in your presence. I'm always there." We may sometimes forsake the assembly, but the Lord does it. He's always here. Solomon says, "For God is in heaven and you on earth." He's not saying now, children and young people, that God is so far away he can't hear or see. He's way up there above the bright blue. You know, the children of Israel once thought this because God has stopped answering their prayers. They thought that God had gotten old and feeble and he couldn't hear good anymore because they weren't being blessed. And it never crossed their mind. The problem was not with God, the problem was with them. Their hearts were not right. Their hearts were not in their worship, and God had stopped hearing their prayers. They had cleanness of teeth. They were hungry. Their tummies were growling. God had turned off the rain. They didn't have anything to eat. So he said, I gave you cleanness of teeth. They were hungry. That made them realize, you know, God, you are in control. You know, we've had a little bit of a drought here lately. We've been praying and praying for rain. Some of us are getting it, some are not. But it makes us stop and realize when we get these droughts and our crops and the corn is twisting and our yards are brown and will burn over, that just how dependent we are upon God. And all the things we take for granted. The children of Israel had gotten away from God. Their hearts were not right with God, and he stopped answering their prayers, and they thought, God, what's wrong with you? But in Isaiah 59 and verse 1, God said, behold, the Lord's hand is not short that I can't save you. My ear is not hard of hearing that I can't hear you, but your sins have separated between you and your God, that he has hid his face from you and will not hear. The children of Israel outwardly worshiping God. They were showing up, but not with their hearts. They were there in body, but not in spirit. Their lives were not right. And so God had stopped blessing them. It was the same with the Pharisees and scribes in Jesus' day. They showed up. They warmed the pews. But Jesus said to them in Matthew 15 and verse 8, these people, they draw nigh to me with their mouth and they honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Again, if God doesn't have your heart, what does he really have of you? They were not coming before God to worship him with a purpose. And we see here in Ecclesiastes 5 and verse 2, Solomon saying, God is always with us. He is the God of heaven. He is there. He is here. He is everywhere. He's omnipresent. And God is God. We are his children, and we are the sheep of his pasture. We're to worship God with a purpose because he's here before us in our worship. What about you this morning? Did you prepare your heart and your mind for worship today? Did you come here with a purpose to glorify God and thank him for the many blessings he's given you? Do you worship with the right perspective, realizing how great and how good God is, just how weak and how frail we are? David said long ago, there is but a step between me and death. David was saying, the psalmist, I don't know, the next step I take may lead me to eternity. David had it in perspective. He said, teach me to know how frail I am. There's just a thread between life and death. Teach me to know how frail I am. That should be our perspective. Folks, if we don't enjoy worship here, we're not going to enjoy heaven, are we? Today, are you a true worshiper? Or is it just something you do maybe out of habit? Is it just something you do on Sunday morning? And maybe your heart hasn't really been in it. Let's make sure that our hearts are right. God didn't say you should worship me in spirit and truth. He said we must worship him in spirit and in truth. Today, if you're not a child of the Most High God, I pray today that you will see how much God loves you. He gave his son to die for you, shed his blood for you, that you might have life and have it more abundantly. His grace is available today. It doesn't matter what you've done or haven't done. If you'll repent, our gracious God will abundantly pardon. If you've never obeyed the gospel, come today, be born again. Born of the water and the spirit, have his blood applied to your life. And that blood will wash away every stain of sin in your life. You can leave here a brand new creation. Old things passed away. All things become new. Leave here with hope today. If you need to come this morning, come right now, but together we stand while we sing.